Dear Lord, thank you for your presence here with us today. Thank you for the sunny day, and thank you for the Sabbath, where we can worship you and take time away from our busy lives to spend with you. And we appreciate you spending time with us today. Watch over us in all that we do. In your name, amen. Please be seated. Good morning, and welcome to College Church. We're glad you've braved the cold to come be with us today. Honestly, I'd rather be cold than hot, so this works for me. Might not work for all of you. Just a few things I'd like to draw your attention to. In the back of your bulletin are several membership transfers that are now second reading. I will entertain a motion to accept these transfers, both in and out. There's a motion and a second. All those in favor? Aye. It's carried. Thank you for your attention. Also, there's a call for singers, both young and old, to join our sanctuary choir as printed in the bulletin. I'd like to draw your attention to that. At this point, I'd like to invite some guests up to the bulletin to join, up to the platform to join me for our next segment.
Good morning, church family, and happy Sabbath. We have some guests. I would like you to say hello and wave to our guests.
Hello.
They're a little nervous, and that's very nice to do. The Atlantic Union Conference presents In It Now. This is the kickoff emphasis on the women that have been violently abused. Beside my wife, we have Jennifer, and right here beside me is Nancy. They're from the Worcester community. We only were given a few seconds for a huge global problem, and that is violence against women. These young ladies have volunteered, a little nervous, to come and share just a little bit of their experience. And again, it's only a few minutes we can spare, but again, they volunteered to share, and I'm gonna turn it over to them now.
Hi, my name is Nancy, and I can remember being in an abusive relationship, and I was really hurt by that. You know, I felt hurt. My self-esteem went down real low. And, you know, and I thought it was love, you know, but I was always taught that love doesn't hurt. And, you know, going through that pain and experience, you know, now I've learned that love doesn't hurt. And, you know, I just want to let the ladies know that, you know, you don't have to be verbally abused, mentally abused, physical abused to feel that you know, that someone has to love you, you know, because it's hard to let go, especially when you're in an abusive relationship, because you feel like, you know, you always feel like it's your fault that you're being abused, or why is he talking to me like that, you know, and it's not your fault. It's not. So, you know, and it starts off becoming verbal at first, you know, then it progresses, you know, and if I don't really know, you know, too much to say about it, but it's just, I just want you to know that that's not love.
Okay. Jennifer. Hi, my name is Jen, and like Nancy said as well, At a young age, I got into a relationship with older men, and the way I thought they loved me, I did anything and everything they said, you know, it didn't really matter. And I accepted the physical abuse, mental abuse, sexual abuse from them because I wanted to fit in and I wanted to be loved. And my father and my mother was never there for me. And come to realize that, you know, the older guys wasn't the type of guys that I needed to be with. It was kind of like a father figure to me. And at the time, I didn't realize it. And like Nancy said, like, when you're being abused, the abuser makes you feel like it's your fault. And tries to convince you that it's your fault. And says, well, if you didn't do this, I wouldn't have did this to you. And like, it becomes an obsession and an addiction. And you just find yourself being in back-to-back relationships as that, because that's all you know. And today I know that like God doesn't want me to be in a relationship where men want to hurt me or I want to hurt somebody else, you know, and like the abuse needs to stop, you know. It happens all around the world. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's give her them. See, it wasn't that bad, was it?
No.
We do love you. We do love you, right? I want to thank him again, and my co-worker Donna Diggs is here. She transported them here, provided transportation. They have to leave because of their schedule, yep. But again, I'm hoping to see them back.
Okay. You will.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Right. And again, if you have not gone on the website of the AtlanticUnion.org and signed up for End It Now campaign, we're encouraging you to do that. Again, there's definitely abuse that's going on, and we as Adventists want to make sure that we do our part in stopping it. Thank you.
Please join me in the call of worship by reading the bold print. Let the word go forth, the king bids his children approach. Respond on our behalf. We come at his bidding. Unworthy children, he deems your reproach as precious. We do not fathom this, but we revel in his joy.
Please be seated. I feel mildly schizophrenic this morning. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and tells me I am his own. Man, I look forward to that day. Man. Our offering this morning, as listed in the bulletin, is for World Church Budget, specifically for the General Conference session. What a joyous event that is every few years when the church can get together as a whole. I have actually never had the privilege of going to a GC event. People, and I tell them that, looked really surprised at me, especially since I'm a pastor's kid. But, you know, I look forward to that world conference in the sky someday when we can all walk with him and talk with him. Again, our offering today is for World Church Budget. The deacons will wait upon you. now, dear Lord, put your hands upon these offerings as we release them to you. We thank you for your gifts, and we pray that your gifts will continue to give to those who need them the most. Watch over this money as it serves you. In your name, amen. Please be seated.
Before the children come, we have a presentation of some of the things that our young people are doing in the church, and we're very excited about the growing ministry that's happening, and the young people are getting excited about getting involved in ministry. And one of the things, if you look in your bulletin, you'll see the youth and schools of Lancaster are planning on doing the 30-hour famine. Every 7 seconds, a child dies from hunger or hunger-related causes, and it feels like sometimes we can't do much about it, but because World Vision has been doing this since the mid-90s, and they've also teamed up with government organizations, we actually can do something about it. Every dollar the kids raise, it goes to feed a child for one day, and there's a U.S. government agency that's matched that 10 times. So actually, every $1 kids raise is $11 and 11 children that they can feed for a day. By doing this, the kids are going to go hungry for 30 hours, and we are going to have a very fun time being hungry for 30 hours. We're going to go into lockdown on Friday night on the 26th and come out on the 27th. And during that time, we're going to be volunteering in a soup kitchen and participating in activities that we learn about hunger around the world and get the kids involved. So they will be fundraising. We'll also be fundraising as a church. But to get you a little excited about it, we have a little video that I would like you to look at over here on the wall.
Good Amisha Havoshan Masharanya Dolok Fara Hirimorui.
Listen.
You can make a difference.
You can make a difference.
Good Amisha Havoshlens. Mashingaranya Doluk Fara.
Are going to do something, and we're excited to watch this happen, and we're excited to be a part of it. And you can help, and there's ways you can help, but we also can have fun doing this. And we have designed a few different fundraisers that we're really looking forward to, one of which I'm going to have my helpers come up here and help me. We have a very exciting opportunity for you. You know, I just recently learned that the pink plastic flamingo was made in Massachusetts, right? Is that true? People are nodding at me. So how appropriate that we have a fundraiser that involves pink plastic flamingos. And what you can do, it's actually quite fun. You can pay to have a flock of pink plastic flamingos sent to any yard of your choice. And you can do this. You can have it sent to any yard if you happen to receive the wonderful pink flamingos, since they're so classy, and you might not actually want them on your front lawn. You can pay to have them removed, which we will do for you happily. However, if you know Selena Trott at any level, you might want to purchase what you call flamingo insurance, which means that you cannot have the flamingos sent to your yard. So if you know Selena on any level, please, or Tim, please get flamingo insurance, because I'm sure you will have a lot of flamingos on your yard if you know her. So you can purchase flamingo insurance. And these are my helpers who are in charge of this, Yvonne, Alexa, and Karis. They are going to be tracking our flamingo flock and making sure that they go to the appropriate places and get removed from the appropriate places. And they also know the suggested pricing if you would like to speak to any of them, or you can contact me and I will put you in contact with them. So that is one of our first fundraisers that will be ongoing until the famine happens. We will also have some other ones coming up that will keep you notified of. But thank you so much. And thank you guys, you can sit down. And before we start our children's offering, I also want to just apologize for the mess that's downstairs. And I know that we've had a lot of things going on, but we're also very excited because our primary two room is really going to be shaping up. And we really had people who have put a lot of effort and energy into making it something that's really creative and captivating for the kids. And I think that's so important. It really is going to be just something that we hope is really something the kids can't wait to get up on Sabbath morning and get to. So we're very excited about that. However, we do have some more expenses. We've got the flooring, and the flooring is going down, but we do want to create a really special wall mural that goes on that big, long wall, and we're going to get the art department over at AUC to paint us a canvas, but that's not free because it takes supplies and it takes time as well. So we are asking that as you give money this morning for the children's offering, to think of the primary two-room and the canvas that we are hoping to put up to make this an imaginative and beautiful program for our kids. Thank you so much for all that you've invested in our children already, but the kids can come forward now for a children's story. Kids are such good fundraisers. They just look at you. I saw Nicholas. He was counting his money, and he looked at somebody like, I need more. Yeah, kids are such good fundraisers. I need to send them out all the time. Yeah. Okay, hi, boys and girls. How are you doing? Happy Sabbath. I have a story for you today about little Sammy. But first of all, can I have a volunteer? Okay, Brianna, can you come try to move this rock for me? Don't hurt yourself, okay? Oh, it's quite heavy, isn't it? Okay, who else wants to try? Okay, you want to try? You try. Try for me, okay? Oh, okay, don't hurt yourself. Kids are gonna go home with like bags. Okay, one more, you can try. I think she might get somewhere. Oh, okay, don't hurt yourself, that's good, thank you. Okay, it's very hard to move that rock, huh? And Sammy, okay, no more. Yeah, you can ask your parents what they need carried after a children's story. Maybe they can have you carry something. So one day Sammy was playing in the sandbox, and he was making roads and digging ditches, and he had his little cars out, and he was really having a fun time with this. And he was in the middle, and all of a sudden his little shovel went dink, and he's like, oh, what's that? And then he was planning to build a big well there, a big lake. But what was in the middle of the sandbox? It was a huge, big rock like that. And he said, well, that's not very good for my plans. I need to put a lake there, so I think I better get this rock out. And so little Sammy, he was struggling with the rock, and he started to push it really hard. Oh, and he kind of got it a little bit. And then he sat down and he used his legs, and he was pushing with his legs to try to get the rock out of the sandbox. And it was going, but he got it over to the edge, and he couldn't get it over the side of the sandbox because there was a little wooden, you know, retaining wall thing that he couldn't get over. And he was so discouraged, he started to cry because he had tried his very, very best, and he couldn't get this big boulder out of the sandbox. And he was just looking at it, and tears were coming down his eyes, and he was so upset. And then all of a sudden, a shadow comes over him, and he looks up, and who do you think it is? It's Daddy. Daddy's there, and Daddy has big arms, right? Daddy has big arms, and Daddy said, Sammy, what's the problem? Sammy says, I have a rock in my sandbox, and I can't get it out. And Dad said, well, why didn't you use all of your strength? And Sammy said, I did use all my strength, and I tried so hard to even use my legs, and I couldn't get out of the sandbox. And Daddy said, no, you didn't use all your strength. He said, because this whole time I was in the house watching you, and I could have come out at any time you would have asked to help you get the big rock out of the sandbox. You had me, so you didn't use all your strength. And you know, that's how it is with God. Sometimes we try so hard to overcome the things in our lives all by ourselves, right? And we use all our strength, and we fail, and we get really discouraged. But actually, we have somebody who promises that he'll be there all the time. And in Psalms 46:1, it says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said, I'm ever-present help, an ever-present help. Do you guys know what an ever-present help means? He's always there. He's always there, an ever-present help. And he'll be willing to help you at any time. So remember that next time you have a big problem in your life and it's too big for you, remember that you have extra strength through Jesus, okay? Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for all you've done for us, for all your love. We love you so much. Help us to obey our mommy and daddy and to do what we're told so that we can glorify you in your name. Amen. Okay, you can go back to your seats. Who wants to get the rock? Take it out. I'm kidding. I'm going to get... No, don't do it, because go out. It's okay. I'll get somebody. Where's my husband?
Way to go, Dustin. As the children find their seats, I invite all those young at heart to come up front and join me as we pray together today. So as we sing our prayer song together, you are welcome if you feel the need to come forward and pray. Join me. Thank you. Oh, loving Father, thank you for today. Thank you for knowing beforehand our needs and knowing that we really needed this Sabbath. Thank you for knowing everything about us, for knowing how to put us together, and mostly how to recreate us, because we all need you so much. Lord, there's a prayer list in our bulletin, and the names are there, some of them for a while, some of them for not so long. And it's so wonderful to see some of those who have been on the prayer list back here with us today and each week. Because, Lord, we know that you hear our prayers, and you are the great physician and are capable of doing anything. And you've promised us that when we ask, you hear us and will answer us. So, Lord, we especially ask today for those on the list, Edith and Rick, and Randy, and Stan, and Biz, and Cliff, and Juliet, and Thor, and Ellie, and Eugene, and Laura Lee, and Susie, and Janie, and BJ, and Peggy, and Amanda. And I'm sure, Lord, that that is not the entire list, because each one of us here needs you, not just those on the list. Each of us needs your strength, just like Pastor Heather talked about today. Help us to rely upon you and not on ourselves, but to give that up and say, Lord, just do it. Thank you for the blessings of this community around us. Thank you for our families and friends. And Lord, we pray that today, as we approach your throne, you give us an extra special blessing of your mercy and grace. Forgive us of our sins and wash us anew, ready for another week. We pray for those around the world who are hungry, especially the children. And we thank you for the efforts of our children here, who are doing all that they can to help those who aren't as fortunate as us. Help us to give without end, Lord, as you have given to us. And now as we separate after this service today for the rest of the week, go with us. Fill us with your strength. Make us your glory in this community. May we glorify your name in all that we do, and may bring honor to you and more into your fold, so that when you come home, we can all be with you. We pray in your name. Amen.
The living word is from Deuteronomy chapter 20, verses 3 through 17. I'm reading from the Jerusalem Bible. You shall have no gods except me. You shall not make yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything in heaven or on earth, beneath or in the waters under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, Yahweh, your God, am a jealous God, and I punish the father's fault in the sons, the grandsons, and the great-grandsons of those who hate me. But I show kindness to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not utter the name of Yahweh your God to misuse it, for Yahweh will not leave unpunished the man who utters his name to misuse it. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath for Yahweh your God. You shall do no work that day, neither you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your servants, men or women, nor your animals, nor any stranger who lives with you. For in 6 days Yahweh made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that these hold, but on the seventh day he rested. That is why Yahweh has blessed the Sabbath day and made it sacred. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may have a long life in the land that Yahweh your God has given to you. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his servant, man or woman, or his ox or his donkey, or anything that is his.
Good morning, church. I agree with Tim. I like the cold better than the hot. My husband thinks we're going to retire somewhere in the South. I've told him it's not going to happen. Well, he's not here today, so don't tell him. These commandments are very interesting. And although I don't claim to say any one is more important than the other, I do feel that one is a sticky wicket. And let's just discuss that, and let me share my interpretations this morning. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for loving us. Thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to serve you. Help us open our hearts and try to understand. You do say, let us reason together. So here we go, Lord. Be with us and guide us in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I'd like to go over those commandments once again. Can we turn to Exodus 20, verse 3? We're gonna go over them briefly because I know we all know the commandments. But I'm gonna just share a little what I think, and then we can get to the commandment that I feel is a sticky wicket. Are you ready? You shall have no other gods before me. Do we have any gods before us? Well, could be the house, right? Kind of, in a way. Now, how about the car? You know, something we put, you know, we really don't say it's a god before our God, but could be a little something that we have there. What do you think? Maybe this is it? Nah. Let's go to the next one. No carved or graven images. Well, we don't do that, do we? I don't see any images here. And so maybe we're covered on that one, right? Okay, let's go to the next. Don't take the name of the Lord in vain. What do? We say, oh gosh, instead of oh God. But we're covered, right? Cool, I like that. Remember the Sabbath day. We're all here. hey, this is okay, we're keeping the Sabbath. I have a friend whose mother goes to the mall, and if sunset is 6:05, she's sitting in the parking lot of the mall, and when it's 6:05, she steps right into the mall. Hey, that's keeping the Sabbath, right? I'd say so. Honor your father and your mother. I honor my parents. I call my mom and my dad. Actually, I was talking to my dad last night, you know, shooting the breeze, and I'm doing the daughter thing, you know. You shall not commit murder. We don't murder, do we? That's the big commandment. We don't murder, right? We just might kill somebody with what we're saying about them, right? A little bit, kind of, in a way. And we don't commit adultery. That's the commandment that we as Adventists, that's the biggie, right? We do not commit adultery. I was told once that it's okay to look, as long as you don't do anything. Again, my husband's not here, so don't say anything. Okay, and don't steal. We don't steal, do we? Well, we might just stretch the truth a little bit in that tax, you know, report and all that kind of stuff, just a little. And then we don't bear false witness. I was told once that if it's the truth, it's not gossip. Sounds good to me. And then this last commandment, I don't understand it. Do you understand thou shalt not covet? That's a sticky wicket. What does that mean, thou shalt not covet? As a young kid, I'd like to still consider myself young, but I always thought it was like a commandment that was just like there. You know, God just wanted to throw something in, the last commandment. Thou shalt not covet. What does that mean? I work at Atlantic Union College, and sometimes I travel quite a bit. And so before I leave, I try to remind my husband, you know, what's coming up so he doesn't forget. I try to remind our son, Gerald, that don't forget garbage day on Wednesday and, you know, do this and do that. But when I'm ready to leave, the last thing I say is, I love you, right? Because put everything in a nutshell, put it all, what's really important? I love you. That's the last thing I say. I'd like for us to focus on that a little bit this morning. For example, Jesus came so that we could be saved, okay? What was the last thing that was told for us to do? The Great Commission? Can we turn to Matthew 28, verse 19, real quick? What do we find over there? Go ye therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded with you, and lo, I am with you always until the end of the earth. So Jesus shared everything he shared, correct? He taught us. And then at the end, he said, go ye. If we turn again to Mark 16:15, the message is pretty much the same. He says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. It's pretty much the same. Could it be that he's using, or we can use, or I can use this same concept in the last thing that I say before I leave on a trip that's really important, or the last thing, our Great Commission, or this last commandment? Could it be a commandment that could make us break all the other commandments, our envy, our covetousness? Could this commandment be more than what we really think? I'm a third generation Adventist, and I've seen baptisms, camp meetings everywhere since a little girl. And I've seen people share their testimony. I've never seen someone say, oh, Lord, I've coveted, please forgive me, I'm going to be baptized now. Has anybody ever heard that? No, I've heard people say, oh, I've stolen, I've lied, I didn't keep the Sabbath, I had all these adulterous relationships, I've even murdered. I've never heard someone say, I coveted things that weren't mine, or people that weren't mine, or whatever. What does the Bible say about coveting? Proverbs 14:30. We could go real quick. I know I can't take up too much time. It says, a heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. Dr. Follett, rotting the bones, what does that mean? Rotting the bones. I'm not in healthcare, but I know it's something that's not good. Rotting the bones. Ecclesiastes 4:4 states, and I saw that all labor and all achievement spring from man's envy of his neighbor. What are we envying? I'm going to look to the Bible real quick and see if we can see any ideas that really come out referencing envy or covetousness. 2 Samuel 11:2. Can we turn there real quick? Yeah, when I was young, I was in Pathfinders, and we had to go all over the Bible, so it's still my thing. Go from one verse to the next. I think it's fun, you know? Amen. I have this John Maxwell's Bible, Leadership Bible, and that's what I'm using today, okay? 2 Samuel 11:2 says, then it happened one evening that David arose from his bed and walked on the roof of the king's house. And from that roof, he saw a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful. So David sent and inquired about the woman, and someone said, told him who she was. In the New James Version, it says, New King James, it says, and someone said. In the Amplified Version, it says, and one said. In the New Living Translation, it says, and he sent someone to find. And in the New International Version, it says, David sent a messenger. So David saw somebody who was there bathing. I don't know if she should have been bathing out there so that someone could see her, but who knows? And he sent a messenger, and he found out who she was. She was a wife of somebody, right? Uriah. And what did he say? He sent his messengers, okay? And he said, they took her, and she came to him, and he laid with her, for she was cleansed from her impurities, and she returned to her house. Listen, I talked to those students out there across the street. This is better than the Young and the Restless of the General Hospital, right? Wow. And he called her and took her. And then she conceived, and she said, I am with child. Wow. She had to tell somebody she was with child, another messenger. I was once told that sex without love or marriage can lead to violence, something we need to keep in mind. I'd like to share Abby's interpretation of what happened. I don't want to get anybody in trouble, okay? As David sent these messengers to get Bathsheba, I think there was a lot of talk, don't you think? You know, beforehand, people are talking about he went to get her, and then she finally came to him, and what happened. And then I'd like to think about Uriah and what happened to him. My idea is that when David decided or realized that he was in trouble, did a little backpedaling, right? And so he figured, let me get Uriah here and let me see what I can do to maybe let him think it's his kid. You understand what I'm saying? And I like Uriah. You know, my heart goes out to him. You know, what could he do? He couldn't go against the king. And then his wife, that woman, I gotta tell you something. Maybe the king was good looking, I don't know. All the money, who knows? But poor Uriah, what did he decide to do? He said, I'm gonna take care of this. So what happened? He stayed outside the door from his house that night, right? Two nights, actually. I could see him walking down the halls of Haskell Hall before he got to the president's office. Oh, I'm sorry, did I say that? I could see him walking down to the courts, correct? And everybody talking, all those messengers telling him what happened, what his wife had done. And then he makes this decision. Well, we all know what happened. David coveted something or someone that wasn't his. He lied. He was deceitful. He committed adultery. And then he murdered. You know, oftentimes it's very hard for us. We see people like that and we say, oh, gee, I'm so glad I'm not like that. But are we? What is it that I covet? What is it about Abby that needs to fix? What does Abby envy? I'm sure what I envy, you don't envy. I'm sure that my problem is not your problem. But sometimes we have difficulty even trying to realize what problems we have. Because, you know, you look in the mirror, I look okay. Except for about 8 or 9 pounds, but other than that, it's okay. And I'm this and I'm that, everything is cool. You know, and we all do that. We look at each other, you know, we look in the mirror, everything looks okay. And then we go to the Lord and ask him to help us, correct? But we usually ask him to help us not with the things we think we have mastered and we can take control over, correct? And those are probably the things that we need the most help with. Okay, so sometimes we might look in the mirror and say, hey, there's nothing wrong with me. Let me give you a little pointer. If you want to know what's wrong with you or what needs to be fixed, you might ask some people that aren't very close to you. You know, the people you don't get along with very well. They'll be happy to share with you what problems you have. I could tell you this, 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 this. And you're like, wow, you know? And I'd like to look at the Bible for myself as I read and as I study what I can use for me. I like to use the examples in the Bible for me. And the example I learned from David, although it's a very interesting story, you know, why did they slide that in about Bathsheba? You know what I mean? That whole relationship thing. I'd like to think that there's hope for me. That although I can really, really mess up, there's hope for me. And sometimes we really, really, really mess up, but nobody really, really finds out. Poor David, everybody knew what was in his closet. You know, he just, everybody knew his problem. But he humbled himself and he asked the Lord for forgiveness. Okay, so what do we do? What am I coveting? Well, I don't know. It might be somebody else's job, their home. Well, as long as their home is smaller than mine, it's okay, right? And as long as my car is a newer model than theirs, it's okay too. Is that right? We do that. We play games with each other, with ourselves too. Sometimes we usually need to be honest, and we need to ask God to help us. Sometimes we don't think we have any problems. I'm going to share a story. Years ago, my husband and I worked with young people. We still do. They're a little older now here across the street. And we would organize mission trips for the conference. And we would take the young people on mission trip. And we had a young man who went to school with our daughter. His name was Chris. Chris was so cool. Okay, and we took him on the one mission trip, and we took him on a second mission trip. But then there was a problem with Chris. He couldn't keep his pants on. And that doesn't work when you're taking care of other people's daughters. You know, when they say, take care of Mary, take care of Sally, and then you got Chris right over here. That doesn't work, you know. So we had a real serious problem with him. And so we said, how are we gonna take care of this? So we, all of us adults, because you know, adults know a lot. We said, we're gonna keep an eye on him. And we did, all of us. We just like, wouldn't let him out of our sight. And then we got back stateside and we had this big meeting. You know, Adventists, we like meetings, you know, it's good, you know, have these meetings, committees. And my husband was there, I was there, the youth director was there, Chris's mom, and Chris was there, okay? And we spoke to Chris and we explained to Chris the problems and the ramifications of, you know, premarital sex and this whole thing. You understand what I'm talking about. You've heard that little before, right? And so we explained to him, and he was like, uh-huh, and just listening and nodding his head. And then the youth director said, why don't we just pray? You know, just ask for blessings, ask the Lord to help us, you know, Chris, with your problem, and so forth and so on. And then my husband had this brilliant idea, and he said, well, before we pray, Chris, can we ask the Lord, do I have your permission to ask the Lord to take away your will and desire to have sex before you're married? Whoa. He said, uh-uh. He almost had a heart attack. He was like, what are you, crazy? No, no way, Mr. Soares. No, 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 no. And I was shocked at my husband for asking. And Chris's mom was so embarrassed. I mean, she turned all different colors. And the youth director was shocked, and Chris was like, no, it's not gonna happen. So we said some kind of prayer, and that was it. Very funny, isn't it? Well, what about us? How many of us feel comfortable enough that tonight we can sit on our sofa and say, God, I have a problem like Chris. And I give you permission to come into my heart and change my will and help me not be envious of da-da-da-da-da and da-da-da-da-da so that I don't have to do things that are not pleasing to you. Because God started something in each and every one of us. And because of sin and self, we've gotten in the way. And we're really not quite exactly what God wants us to be, are we? And so we laugh at Chris, and we need to look at ourselves. Years ago, it was hard for me to understand handing over my will to God. I go back to what I said a little while ago. Well, God, you can help me with this, but I don't need your help with this and this. I got it all down packed. Just work with me on this problem. And I'm sure I've mediocre intelligence, and some of the people here might think the same way. But I was taught something a little different. As I continued to study the Bible, I like to look at the verses and try to understand them a little bit more and delve into it. My mom has a habit of reading her Bible. She reads kind of quickly. And then she says, I just finished reading the Bible again in 9 months. Okay, and then we're sitting down talking to her, and I never heard of that. Her mom. So I said, as a young child, I always remembered I didn't want to read the Bible fast like my mom did. You know what I mean? I wanted to read a little slower so I could understand what God was trying to say to me, right? So I found a verse in Luke 21:38, and it said, all the people came early in the morning to him in the temple to hear him. So I said, okay, so it was God's custom to go to church and to be in the, you know, early in the morning, this thing. God wanted to be to church on time. Okay, we've got a problem there. Got to be to church on time, right? All right, so let's continue. I kept reading, you know, go to church on time and go too. Sometimes we don't go. Then I read Proverbs 8:17 once, and it said, I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. Do you often find sometimes you start your day and you have so much to do and you just don't have time to read? You know, to spend your time with God. And then by the time you realize it's 9 or 10 in the morning and it was like, well, thank you, bless me, goodbye, and you just keep moving. And that's your prayer. That was your devotion for the day. I don't think that's what the Lord wants of us. I think he wants a relationship. It's kind of like when you're dating. You know, you're just hanging out, eating, you know, and you have a piece of spinach in your tooth, and you're like, okay, you know. But you're getting to learn about somebody. You're getting to understand somebody, you know. And I think we need to understand God and ask him to help us and seek him early. If we seek him early before anything happens, at home, when Adamir and Gerald are sleeping, that's when I do my thing. You know, I put in the laundry and turn on the dishwasher, and then I do my thing with God. But it took me years to get to the point of saying, okay, all right, I permit you to change in me what needs to be changed. I permit you to make me who you want me to be. Because of course, if I, once I got to the point of doing that, and if you do that, then we have to relinquish the idea that I'm perfect. And I guess we're not, are we? And the only way we can aim and reach to perfection is with the Lord. So I've learned to take my time early in the morning, spend some time with God, and give him permission to change in me what needs to be fixed. When we don't let the Lord into our hearts and we don't permit him to do that, we will covet. We will be envious of people. And in so doing, we will not be who the Lord wants us to be. Earlier this morning, we were talking Sabbath school about how to deal with certain situations in our lives. And sometimes, after we've dealt with a situation over and over, we know what to do, what to say. Have you ever had this happen to you, or do you ever say something like, why does this always happen to me? It could be the Lord trying to get your attention and trying to polish up a little something that needs polishing. But we're so busy sometimes running to and fro that we don't take the time to ask him. Sometimes things happen to us and we blame other people and we don't know why. I'd like to say in closing, yes, I'm going to stop. The soul that God has created and that Christ has redeemed is of great value because of the possibilities before it. The spiritual advantages, that have been granted it, the capabilities that it may possess if vitalized by the Word of God, and the immortality it may gain through the hope presented in the gospel. Christ left 99 that he might seek and save one lost sheep. I would like to think that I'm that lost sheep, that he came to save me. Sometimes we hear stories, you know, in churches, people share what the Lord has done to them, how he's changed their lives. And we say, wow, that is so cool. But he wouldn't do that for me. And he will. We just need to ask him. We just need to kind of put self aside and say, okay, Lord, I permit you to make me the way you want me to be. And I permit you to take my will. And rest assured, once we let him and we can be under his wings, he will make us wonderful, wonderful people. And we'll be ready when he comes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Father, for loving us. And thank you for sharing so much in your Bible that we can be better people and understand. Please be with us throughout the Sabbath. And thank you once again for this day that we can rest and reflect on what you've done for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.